Welcome to this special edition of Go Vote Omaha. This is a primary election forum for the Omaha City Council, Districts 3 and 4, presented by the League of Women Voters of Greater Omaha. I'm Geri Simon, a League member and moderator for the forum. The League of Women Voters never supports or opposes political parties or candidates. We present this forum solely for voter education. Here's the format for our forum this evening. Each candidate will have a one-minute opening statement. We'll follow that with questions prepared by the League of Women Voters or called in by our audience, and please do call in your questions, the number is on your screen. Each candidate will answer every question and will have up to 90 seconds to answer the question. The candidates have agreed to abide by the format for this evening and stick to the issues when answering questions. No personal attacks on other candidates will be tolerated or allowed. We'll conclude our forum with one-minute closing statements by each candidate. Before the forum this evening, our candidates drew lots to determine their initial speaking order, and I'll introduce them to you in that order now. We'll alternate the order throughout the forum. There are six candidates with us this evening. The first one is Mark Elworth Jr., running in District 3, J.R. Jasso, District 3, Jim Rogers in District 4, Gilbert Ayala, District 3, Rebecca Barrientos-Patlan, District 4, and Deshaun Cunningham, running in District 3. And now we'll start with our opening statements, beginning with Mark Elworth, Jr.
First off, I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters for putting this on, having us here. They're all volunteers. I really appreciate what they do for our community here, putting this unbiased information out. My name is Mark Jr. A lot of people know me as the guy on the corner trying to legalize marijuana. I have a petition, I run statewide. I've been doing it for years, probably since 98. I've actually been petitioning to legalize medical marijuana, recreational marijuana, even have my own party, the Legal Marijuana Now Party. But this year I'm actually running for the Green Party of Nebraska. Really working to help bring them back, to get our petitions taken and put on the ballot, because we plan to run candidates in 2018. So it's a big part of my effort here. Bring awareness to a lot of important issues, new issues I want to talk about. Best is to check out my website. I'm not really going to have enough time here to talk about all my issues, but I have a lot of new innovative ideas. Free Wi-Fi systems, solar energy grids, all kinds of good stuff. Please check it out. Thank you.
Thank you. J.R. Jasso.
Hi, my name is J.R. Jasso. I'm a lifelong resident of Omaha. I want to thank the League of Women Voters for having us here this evening. There are three things that I want to address as I run for City Council. This is the second time that I've run for this seat. The first thing I'd like to talk about, actually we might get into a little bit later, I want to make our neighborhood safer. And there's a couple ways we can go about doing this, and hopefully we'll have the opportunity later that I can get into some more details. The second thing I would like to do is bring economic development into the Omaha area and into District 3 in particular. And finally, the third thing that I want to impress upon people is I will be a steward with your money. I know you work hard for your money, and I'm going to make sure that it's spent properly and that we make no money go to waste. Thank you.
Thank you. Jim Rogers.
Well, thank you to Geri Simon and the League of Women Voters for this forum. I am running for this office because of the people who live here. I learned in former Congressman Ashford's office the absolute importance of constituent services, which makes me uniquely qualified to be the next councilperson for Ward 4. The people who live in and love our community are our most untapped resource. We can find solutions to a range of issues by engaging our fellow Omahans. Having grown up in South Omaha, I have a deep appreciation for the wealth of culture that exists within our community. We can utilize this diversity as we capitalize on the opportunity to grow our economy and expand event tourism. We have pressing issues in front of us, and there is one issue above all others in this race. We need to fix our streets. I've said that since I began my campaign, and I hear it every day from voters as I knock on their doors. This is the highest priority of my campaign and as a future council member.
Thank you. Gilbert Ayala.
I wish to say thank you to the League of Women Voters for sponsoring this event and to the fellow candidates who are here tonight. My name is Gilbert Ayala, and I've been married for 19 years, and I am the proud father of two twin sons, Winston and Truman. I am running to give the voters of the 3rd District a choice. My politics is conservative. I voted for Ted Cruz in the primary, and I voted for Donald Trump, for President Donald Trump. I support a decrease of 5% in city spending. I think our spending in the city is too high. And I support decreasing property taxes by 5%, And I support the elimination immediately of the restaurant tax. And I support the ending of good time laws, and I support voter ID, and I am pro-life, and I oppose same-sex marriage. And I'm looking forward to this debate tonight, and I hope to, that's about it.
Thank you. Rebecca Barrientos-Patlan.
Thank you, and thank you for the to the League of Women Voters also. I'd like to tell you that I'm a South O girl, born and raised. I have a beautiful husband, beautiful children, 20 grandchildren plus. And my family, I'm 15 of 16 children, over 300 nieces and nephews. That's why I've been working hard for quality of life for South Omaha. I've worked air quality, I've worked, and when I say that, I've been on every board that you can imagine. I've been working, my feet have been on the ground. And I'm not stopping because I care about my community. I love South Omaha, and now that west of 72nd has been added, I think that I think we're gonna do a great job. I think I'm gonna do a great job as a city council person. Thank you.
Thank you. Jashawn Cunningham.
I want to start out by thanking the League of Women Voters for having this forum tonight, and I want to thank the other candidates for appearing here as well. My name is Jashawn Cunningham, and I'm running for city council because I feel that no other candidate nor the incumbent has had as strong a record for working to improve public safety as I have as a private citizen by making police oversight a reality. In 2013, I began work with the OPD chief and the mayor's office to begin having police oversight of Omaha by drafting the first proposals and budget for the on-body worn cameras and independent oversight board. The reforms for the benefit of the people I have brought to OPD, I plan to bring to other offices as a city councilman. I feel there is currently not enough priority given to the day-to-day needs of the citizens of Omaha. The current council views our neighborhoods as commodities by giving expensive tax cuts to developers, and I aim to defend against this gentrification. I will work to increase jobs and transit in District 3 while keeping our neighborhoods affordable for renters and homeowners.
Thank you. We'll go to our first question. The Omaha mill levy rate for property taxes has been lowered in two of the past 4 years. Should the city lower the mill levy rate this next year? Should that decision be dependent on how the county finally sets its property valuations? And we'll begin with J.R. Jasso.
Obviously, the city really can't do anything to lower the levy. What we have to do, of course, is wait until we get something from the county assessor's office to figure out what kind of money we have to work with. What I would like to do is to be able to lower that so that we can then lessen the burden on the taxpayers, and if we're able to do that, then we can possibly get more people to spend money that they work hard for every day. And what I will do is I'll work to make sure that we can keep our budget in line, and so that we won't have to continue to increase that levy in order to bring more money in. So I would hope that we would be able to do that, and I would be able to do that as a steward of your money.
Thank you. Jim Rogers.
Well, I think the important subject here is to make sure the county property valuations go through their due course. There's been a tremendous amount of feedback I've received going to doorsteps of folks, especially in the western corridor of the district, that have seen tremendous valuation increases. And letting them know what the process is for going through and being able to rebut those valuation hikes. As far as the city decreasing the mill levy, I think the first and foremost thing that I'm hearing from folks at their doorstep is that they absolutely want to see our streets and infrastructure fixed. And if folks know where their tax dollars are being utilized and they see results in our community and improvements upon our streets, I think we can actually work a sensible solution make sure that property taxes are in line and that folks are receiving quality infrastructure.
Thank you. Gilbert Ayala.
There's 23 candidates, I believe, running for city council. I believe I'm the only candidate who believes in cutting city spending. I think we need to cut our city spending. I went to one of the city council meetings, and they spent about $300,000 on consultants. And I just disagree with that. I think there's a lot of waste in our city spending. I believe in cutting our property taxes by 10%, 5%. I think it's easily done. I think we can get rid of the restaurant tax.
One of the things that I also support is I do support putting all city employees, including the fire and the police departments, on free market-based retirements. And that is one of the things we have to do, because I was looking up the statistics and we spent $63 million in healthcare costs for our employees, you know, for retired city employees. So something has to be done with the costs, and nobody really wants to deal with it. I will deal with it. I will, when I'm running for city council, if I get elected, I will be there at the city council meetings and I will go over everything that we're spending on consultants, and I will make sure that we do get a 10% decrease in city spending. And I don't think there really is a concern among all these people here today or even the other candidates to really cut city spending. I will do it. Thank you.
Thank you. Rebecca Barrientos-Path.
Today I just received a letter in the mail from one of my constituents, and she was very concerned about the valuations. And I don't think it was a good time for Diane Barrientos to be leaving on such a time as this. I'll tell you, having Mike Boyle and, I'm sorry, I can't think of his name, but you know, I would think that them working together, the Republicans and the Democrats working together for our people, we just have to really streamline a better way, scratch what Diane just did, and for the people's sake, our people can't afford this anymore. And when I say that, I say South Omaha District 4. I am their representative. I always have been the representative. And I may not know all the stats, and I may not know all the perfect words, but I do know my people, and my people need a break. And that's what I want to do for you. Thank you.
Thank you. Deshaun Cunningham.
As far as the property taxes being high, one of the things that I've wanted to make a prime issue in my campaign is, and particularly with District 3, is the clustering of TIF, tax increment financing projects. When you live next to these, your evaluation goes up. So by clustering all these developments, particularly in District 3, we've seen a lot of property evaluations rise. From I've talked with business owners in the area who are not getting the subsidies that some of these newer businesses are getting. So we're creating neighborhoods that are overvalued with tax-funded commercial speculative projects, and there's not enough priority be giving to keeping the neighborhoods affordable, which is something I would want to work on when I get elected. Thank you.
Thank you. Mark Elworth Jr.
Oh, again, I'm running with the Green Party. I'm really proud of my party. I actually consider myself a green conservative. Basically, I really care about people. I care about sustainability in our city. I care about who's coming, and who's going to our city. Basically, I think raising taxes in the middle level would be terrible for our families, for our individuals, for our small businesses. I just would never accept it. I would fight. I've actually done pledges saying I'll fight raising taxes against people. I'm very conservative on raising taxes on families and small businesses. I won't do it. I'm looking for new revenue sources. We need to bring in new revenue sources. And like I said before, I'm the man out here with the marijuana petition. We see what they do in Colorado. We see what they're doing with the schools. We see all the money they're doing to fixing the roads. We see them giving money to the police departments and the fire departments, paying all of their bills. Unlike we're doing here, we can't pay the pensions here. We're broke. We need to bring in some kind of revenue. If it's not marijuana, it's something. I don't know. It's new jobs. It's taxed rich. I don't care. We're not taxing families. We're not taxing poor people. We're not taxing our small businesses. I'm for small businesses. I'm for families. I will not go for taxing anything. No middle level raise.
Thank you. Our next question. Are there services or operations you think the city and Douglas County should consider merging? What about Sarpy County? And we'll start with Jim Rogers.
Well, in order for us to be able to look at merging things across county lines, that would require a change from our legislature, which I don't think is anything that's going to happen anytime soon. In terms of the city and the county, one of the more recent projects that was looking to be consolidated together was the crime lab, which I find is a very interesting unit that should be explored further and try and reignite those conversations in terms of of bringing those entities together. Where things make sense in terms of efficiency for consumers, and then also in terms of being able to provide service, we should absolutely be looking at ways of consolidation. So I would be forthright in supporting those types of measures.
Thank you. Gilbert Ayala.
The merging issue, I think, is not that big a deal. I don't think you're gonna save that much merging a few things here and there. I think really if you're going to cut money and you're really looking to save money, merging may help in a few issues. Obviously the crime lab might be a good thing. But I think really you've gotta get serious at looking at spending. And I think merging's just something that's not gonna save that much money. That's pretty much it.
Thank you. Rebecca Barrientos-Patlan.
Sure. As when we're talking merging, I look at all the services that are out there, and when I'm knocking on doors, people are talking about this. And what's concerning to them is double. We're paying double. Different households are paying double for services, taxes, fees, whatever. I think the problem is, as a CSI student, I think it would be wonderful for Douglas County and City to be merged on. I think it's better service for all around. I've heard that there might have been a problem with uniforms, or Douglas County didn't want uniforms, didn't want to change cars, different things like that shouldn't be a problem when our people are the ones that need the service. And that's it. You know, I think the merge would be good. Thank you.
Thank you. Deshaun Cunningham.
As far as one of the things that has been looked at merging, it didn't go as successfully as some of the people in the Douglas County Sheriffs would have wanted, but having a new crime lab, I know some people may say we don't need a duplication of services, but we need to remember that we had a problem with our crime lab in Douglas County a few years ago with David Kofod tampering with evidence. So I'm for having another crime lab in town for the reason to double check the work, because homicide investigations are very serious, rape clearance cases are very serious, and the last time I talked with the chief, they're working to make improvements in particularly sexual assault reporting, which would be done through something like a crime lab. So there is a time where it would benefit. At this point, Omaha, the city of Omaha, is about a third of the landmass of Douglas County. So I think it makes sense to start merging things now, because there's not really much in the rest of the county to stop Omaha from growing.
Thank you. Mark Elworth Jr.
I really don't want to see overreach of our city too much. As far as merging, I think we could merge maybe on bringing new jobs to the city. I seem to think maybe the Douglas County or Omaha, the city governors, maybe they're just not working on bringing the jobs here. I don't know what the deal is with that. But energy is big. I've been talking about a smart grid for a long time here. I've been talking about putting energy in our own hands, being able to put solar power and wind power under our own houses, and actually produce our own energy instead of using this old energy they're using now, this nuclear energy, which is dangerous, this fossil fuel, the gas, the natural gas. We don't want it. We want to get all of our minds together in the county, in the city level, to make this happen, to put smart grids on. What the smart grid is going to do when this is fully installed, we can actually put our Wi-Fi system, the free Wi-Fi system I talked about, onto the back of this smart grid. But basically, we're going to be able to buy and sell energy, clean, green energy, between me and my neighbors. And it's going to be locally, it's going to be locally produced. Right now we're wasting energy. We're paying tons of bills. They got us in lockdown. I think we should merge our heads together, get something done for Omaha, and then join all the rest of the green cities and the cities moving forward, and just get this done, build a smart energy grid, get everybody working together, everybody in the county on this. Peace.
Thank you. J.R. Jasso.
I believe it's probably a good time right now to think about merging the crime lab for several reasons. One is murders are down, and from what I understand, the crime lab is, what they do is they go in and they investigate those murders. And if murders are down and bad things such as that are down in the city, and if we can merge that, we can save some money. That would be one opportunity to save some money. The second thing,
There was something about something bad with, I can't remember the person who used to lead the crime lab, that something went awry. But I think that now that if the crime lab is under the microscope of that, the people working that will do a much better job because they know they're under the microscope. And so if we can do anything to save any type of money, and I think we could probably save a good deal of money here, and as long as we can continue to provide good services through the crime lab, I think that would be a good possibility to merge and save some money.
Thank you. Here's our next question. What can the city do to promote redevelopment without pricing existing residents out of their neighborhoods? And we'll start with Gilbert Ayala.
I believe that's called gentrification, is when the neighborhood goes up in price. I think that's going to happen, you know, when you have a development. If you put a development in where, you know, people are making on rent, you know, $1,200, $1,400, $1,500 in rent, and you have a house next door, the rents are going to go up. I don't believe there should be a city role in passing any kind of legislation in rent controls, and I think the free market ought to operate. And I would just be opposed to any kind of market rent controls. They don't work. Because when you have market rent controls, you lose available housing. It goes away. So I would just be opposed to any kind of market rent controls. And that's pretty much it.
Thank you. Rebecca Barrientos-Patlan.
You know, I go through South Omaha and I look at homes being built next to homes that have been there for decades. And I look at them and I think, why don't our people have access to monies? I hear there's $700 million that went to North Omaha, and why aren't we in South Omaha getting any of that? I would like to be the city council person that would bring money and help homeowners try to add to their homes their quality of life. We have to look at their children growing up in these areas. And you know, I don't see that developers coming and building these homes right next to existing homes that they charge so much for these homes next to you that the valuations of everybody in that neighborhood rises, and it does. It cuts off funding for these other people that live around there in the neighborhoods. I'm totally for renovations, and I want to be able to help people in their current homes. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Deshaun Cunningham.
This goes back to one of the things I said that I wanted to have be a main focus of my campaign, which is not giving tax money to luxury apartment developers, because when we do this, like I said, it does make the evaluations rise. So one thing that I could do at a city council level is to not fund these projects in the first place. Additionally, beyond that, which would something that would need to be done at a state level, is to have a way to decouple personal property from a rising evaluation from being next to an adjacent property that has such a higher property value or tax value. So when we can decouple those rates from being next to something like a Midtown Crossing, we can keep the neighborhoods affordable. Beyond that, we also, I feel as a councilman, we need to have tougher laws on slumlords. A lot of these landlords are able to rent out of compliance and take advantage of people's desperation. And when that happens, they are at risk of having that property, which was affordable, even though it was out of compliance, that property could become the next renovated home and the rent could triple or quadruple. So that is one of the things I would do in addition to decreasing TIF funding, is to make tougher fines and penalties for slumlords as well.
Thank you. Mark Elworth Jr.
Yeah, it's expensive to have a house and pay the bills and all the utilities, have insurance and everything, but actually in Omaha, I think it's pretty affordable throughout the city. I think the main issue here is that people can't find jobs. It breaks my heart to see that people can't find jobs and people are working two, three, four jobs just to make it. That's a complete joke. People should only have to work one job and to make it and pay these bills. Really, paying $800 and paying bills for an apartment, that's really not that bad. It's just the problem is people can't find work to pay for those bills. I think we need to just brainstorm, think about some jobs, way to create jobs. I mean, I've been out for months and years talking about legalizing marijuana. That's tons of money. I've said before, I mean, I'm running for the Green Party in Nebraska. I love my party. I'm sick of the politics here. I'm sick of the status quo. If you want somebody to do something, that's me, Mark Elworth Jr. I'm the one that's going to do something about this. I'm the one that's going to get jobs in here. I'm the one that's going to bring business here. I'm already calling businesses. I'm already proactive about this. We want businesses here. We want jobs here. We want small business. We got jobs. We can pay our bills. No more working two or three jobs. It's stupid. We're slaves doing that. I'm sick of it. It makes me cry. I'm sick of worrying about it. I'm sick of hearing people's problems about it. It's stupid. We need real jobs.
Thank you. J.R. Jasso.
I believe we can provide affordable housing to all citizens in Omaha. But what we need to do in order to do this is we need to have good paying jobs so that people can do this. The affordable housing is there. It might take a little bit of time to look for it, but it's there. What we need to do is we need to bring the people to the table who are needing this affordable housing, the people who have the affordable housing. We need to get those people out of the table. We have to have a dialogue so we can understand what the needs are from the point of view of the person who needs the home and the point of view from the person who has the property to rent. If we can get these entities together, we can come up with a solution. We're very smart people. We can really do this, and we can make Omaha a better city for everybody.
Thank you. Jim Rogers.
I think the key here is making sure that as we are going through redevelopment projects, to bring together both folks from within the development community and also individuals from neighborhood type groups or individuals that are looking for affordable housing options, and figure out what it is that we can do to make sure that we can incent developers to have an affordable housing stock available. I don't think we need to use the heavy hand of government and say there's a requirement to make that happen, but we need to really sit down and have a frank discussion so individuals who are trying to get ahead and trying to get a leg up and need an opportunity to be able to have an affordable housing option are given that option. That's a working together and bringing groups of folks together is something that I would actively do as a council member. Thank you.
Thank you. Here's our next question. Would you support a city ordinance to require our police department to get city council authorization to purchase or to accept the donation of surplus military equipment? Why or why not? And we'll start with Rebecca Barrientos-Patlan.
Well, most people know that I'm an officer's wife, a retired officer's wife. And the thing is our firemen and our policemen, they need equipment. And if there was something that we needed then, and that was available, I would say yes, go for it, because they know what they need. We as homeowners and residents just expect for them to be, to serve and protect, and we want them to have the appropriate things to be able to serve and protect us. And I just want to say I'm for the firemen and the police officers having what they need. They serve and protect us, and they help us when we need it. And when we call 911, they're there. And homeowners need that. They want that, and they're the first responders that we got to protect. So if they need it, let's give it to them.
Thank you. Deshaun Cunningham.
The question was, should we be pass an ordinance to give the police department military surplus equipment? The idea to even frame that question itself is so flawed. The police department should not be operating as an invading force in the city of Omaha. They are already incredibly well equipped without having any more surplus military. I believe they already have some of the, I forget the name of them, the big wheeled vehicles. They already have some mine resistant vehicles, things like that. They already have a helicopter. So, and not only that, we've seen homicides go down in Omaha. When I started working with the chief's office in 2013, the national average for Omaha's homicides was about 44 a year. For the first time last year, we were under 30, it was 28 homicides. So Omaha is becoming safer without a militarized police department. And if we're talking about passing ordinances, one ordinance I would want to pass is an ordinance requiring OPD officers to live in the areas they patrol. That's exactly to combat this mindset of looking at the community as a war zone. If the officers would look at the citizens as neighbors, we wouldn't have a lot of these problems that we used to have in the past, and we can further decrease instances of problems between the police department and the community. Thank you.
Thank you. Mark Elworth, Jr.
That's a crazy question. Absolutely not. I fully 100% support the police and finding money for their pensions and making sure they can compete and we get the best police officers here and make sure they have brand new cars, brand new equipment, but not military vehicles. What we need to do is make sure people aren't getting in trouble, make sure we have schools that are making sure that kids are smart enough to either go to college or get a job right after school so they don't even have to deal with the police. We don't need tanks rolling down our streets. But we need to take care of our police. This whole militarization is crazy. But you know, if it's a waste of money, I'm sure they'll probably do it. And whatever, we need to open up our heads and think a little bit about what's going on here. Just go to school, kids, and stay out of trouble. You don't want the police arresting you these days. You'll end up in the back of a tank or something. I don't know. It looks pretty scary out there. Be careful. Peace.
Thank you. J.R. Jasso.
Well, I'm going to make the assumption that we're not talking about getting military tanks. I don't ever see that happening, that we would get something like that. I'm sure they're probably talking about something that the city police force could use. So, to say we're going to arm a militia, I don't believe that's going to happen. I believe our police officers are doing a great job, and if they can have some more equipment that would help in a situation where something really bad is happening and all of this equipment could help, I believe that's something that we could do. But again, I don't believe we're going to see tanks rolling down the street. Secondly, if it's an opportunity, we're all up here talking about saving money. If we can save money by getting something secondhand or giving it to us free, then I'm for that. That's maybe some money we can spend somewhere else. But the most important thing is if we get something in that somebody is going to discard, but it's still usable, if it can save lives, then I'm all for it.
Thank you. Jim Rogers.
Well, I certainly don't think we need a city ordinance to be able to acquire military surplus. I think the real question comes down to sitting down with our fellows in law enforcement and asking what do they need in order to be able to do their job. And if they provide information saying, well, we feel that we need a particular piece of equipment and we are able to obtain it at a military surplus rate, then that should certainly be able to save our community money. We need to evaluate as city council members if those indeed are needed by our community. I think overall in terms of looking at other options that might be able to save our city money, if there's fire rigs that are available that we might be able to get as military surplus, then certainly we should be exploring those options. Efficiency is certainly something that I would be striving to achieve. Thank you.
Thank you. Gilbert Ayala.
I would defer kind of the police chief on this. If there's some equipment out there that the military doesn't need and we could use it, I don't see what the problem is. I want to say one thing. I disagree with some of the candidates here who are kind of have an attitude of the police that they're kind of like an invading force. I think most police officers get up in the morning. They don't want to shoot anybody. They want to come back home. They want to go to bed and spend time with their kids. And I think that attitude is kind of wrong on some of the people that are here today. And, if the police chief thinks, that we need this, obviously he would consult with the city council. And if the military or the federal government wants to give it to us for free, I don't see what the issue is or at a reduced rate. And that would be my position.
Thank you. Here's our next question. In 2015, separate pickup of yard waste was eliminated by the mayor. Previously, yard waste went to the Omagrow Center for composting. Now both trash and yard waste go to the landfill. Do you support or oppose the change, and should we go back to separate pickup? And we'll begin with Deshaun Cunningham.
I think there's a lot that can be done to improve the way we collect our trash and dispose of it. There should be separate facilities. Recycling makes sense on numerous levels. As a city, we don't even have a glass recycling center, so that's something that I would want to see built in my time as a city councilman, because right now, if we don't have ways to process things like different types of yard waste or composting or things of that nature, we're just going to end up throwing it in the landfill, and that's a waste of space. It's not environmentally sound. So I think that there should be increased separation of trash pickups, but not only that, the city needs to be proactive in making recycling plants, rendering plants, so we can turn these raw materials back into something to be used for the rest of the city. Thank you.
Thank you. Mark Elworth Jr.
Yeah, I think they should separate it. Of course, they were making the Omaha Grow product out of it. It was a pretty successful product, but actually, it could be made with, you can make energy out of this yard waste. You could make, extract methane out of it, drive cars, drive our city vehicles with it. Produces heat. We could, you know, use heat radiation, this heat schools, whatnot, city buildings. We just need to build it, and it'll be there. But, you know, I guess they just don't have the money to separate it, and they're just throwing it in there. Again, I think we should legalize marijuana, bring that money in here and get this stuff done. Make Omaha a place to come to instead of a place to leave. Businesses are leaving, let's bring businesses here. Kids are leaving, no, let's bring kids here. Let's bring people here. Free Wi-Fi across the whole city. Everybody wants it, young people want it. Let's do it, man. Thank you very much. Peace and love, Mark Jr.
Thank you. J.R. Jasso.
Well, as I've been going around town talking to people, I've learned a couple of different things on this particular issue. One, and this is my own, we only have one planet. We have to take care of it. And if taking care of it means that we need to separate our trash, then I believe that's something we have to do. And I think there are two sets of ideas out there. Those who'd say, yes, let's save the planet. Let's do what we have to do. And then there's the other people that would say, well, it makes more sense and it's cheaper if we make one pass where we pick everything up at one time. So there's going to be those two schools. And the other thing, sometimes we talk about, well, let's use our trash and let's take the methane gas. But I don't really think that there's enough trash that would provide enough methane gas to do as much as we would hope it would be able to do. But I think the bottom line that comes down to is the people that I've talked to, they want to make sure that there's no increase in the price that it's going to cost to move our trash, but they still want it done effectively.
Thank you. Jim Rogers.
Well, as I've gone around door to door and heard from folks about this issue, people really want to take care of our city in two ways. One, they'd really like to see us continue on a pathway where we separate out both our refuse and yard waste. And two, in terms of recycling, I've heard continuously over and over that they'd like to see new barrels or a container with a lid on them. I can't count the number of people who've mentioned to me, you know, I try and do my part in terms of recycling only to have the wind pick up and blow everything all over my neighbor's yard, which I feel terrible about. Is there a way that we can go and address this? In terms of the OmaGrow product, the interesting thing that I've found in my research of that is, not only is this something that we produce here locally, we vend it all around the Midwest. Now, I believe this is an area where we might be able to find a public-private partnership to be able to build an economy from our yard waste that can be utilized by folks from within the Midwest. The second thing is, in terms of the methane plant, I've toured the Elk City methane plant. There's enough methane there to operate that plant until the year 2182. It generates about 6.3 megawatts of power, which is enough to power approximately 4,000 homes.
Thank you. Gilbert Ayala.
I'm going to fall on the side, like Mr. Jasso said, I'm on the side of the people who want less expensive trash pickup. I don't believe that the recycling is cost effective. I think it's very expensive. If we can get the aluminum cans recycled and get some money there, if it's cost effective, let's do it. But I pretty much believe that if it's not cost effective, let's dump it in the dump. I think we're trying to get too fancy, and we're maybe getting into feelings about saving the earth, and I kind of disagree. I think, you know, we can build another dump, we can buy another dump somewhere else out further out in the city, and I think trash ought to be less expensive. The pickup ought to be a lot less expensive. I pay like $100 a month, you know, for a bill, you know, and I think that's ridiculous. And I'm sure 30 years ago it was a lot less expensive. And I just don't think that the recycling is cost effective. And just so that I'm clear on some issues here, there's some candidates here who are saying that marijuana is like a great issue and is gonna bring in a lot of money. I'm totally opposed to that. That's wrong, and I just wanna make sure that people understand where I stand. I think, you know, the legalization of marijuana is an evil thing, and it's not good for our children, and it would not be good for our society. And I just want to let people know that's where I stand. Thank you.
Thank you. Rebecca Barrientos-Patlan.
And brother, I stand with you on that. This is God's planet. This is God's earth. And as a Christian, I believe the same thing. And I know that for a fact that there's people driving under the influence of alcohol. We don't need another vice out there. I also think it's cost effective to keep it all together. The trash needs to stay together. And, you know, I know that there's a contract coming up pretty soon it's Def and Bob, but it's been bought by someone else. I cannot think of that name right now. But people that I knock on doors with, they're afraid. Now, we were just given west of 72nd Street. And the people out there, they have a pilot program going out there, and they have them nice big bins with the lid on it, and they love it. They absolutely love it. Now, if we could get everybody to have one of them so that everybody is included in having that type of pickup, I know it would save a lot of trash, and we have a lot of trash in South Omaha. And let me just say that. People, pick up your trash. It just should not be hanging around, flying around. You're responsible for your business, you're responsible for your homes, and honestly, we want a clean area. We want a clean district. We want a clean South Omaha. So please pick up your trash. Thank you.
Thank you. This will be our last question. Should tax incentives continue to be used for economic growth? And should strong clawbacks, that's to get money back if a business leaves town, be included in development agreements that rely on such incentives? And we'll start with Mark Elworth, Jr.
Well, I definitely don't think we should be giving these to corporations. When we give these away, guess what? Those people don't pay taxes, and why would we give it away to the rich people to take the best corners? It makes no sense to me. We need to take that tax money and pay for our schools that we don't have money for. Instead, the workers have to pay for it, and the families have to pay for it, and the big businesses with this financing, they get off and they're good to go. They don't have to pay taxes for a while, and we do. We need to grow small business. I've been talking on my website about business co-op centers. They're popping up all over the country. What they are, a lot of times the city does start them, but they're basically used malls. They're no longer businesses inside of them. They're just not being used, and they cut them up into small mini malls, and they rent them out for dirt cheap to small businesses. And that's what we should be doing like creating stuff for the community. Small businesses, they can start their new businesses, have a little food court in there. We talk about all of my website, my Facebook page. We should use it to make affordable housing, not a Walmart on 72nd Dodge or wherever they put this stuff. No, small business, not big business.
Thank you. J.R. Jasso.
Tax incentives, I think that's something that could be a double-edged sword. There's the opportunity for a tax incentive to do good if it's able to bring businesses in. Then I would be for it, because if we can do that, we can bring jobs in, good-paying jobs. We can put people to work, and if we're able to do that, then what are they going to do? They're going to go out and they're going to spend their money. That's going to broaden our tax base. We're going to have more money coming in. But what I believe is that before we can give tax we have to have tax cuts before we can have tax breaks. And as far as the issue of clawbacks, I mean, why wouldn't we want to get that money back? If somebody, I would like to have the opportunity to have somebody give me money that I'm going to invest something and it doesn't work out and then I leave and I don't have to pay it back. Should we go after that money? I believe we should.
Thank you. Jim Rogers.
Well, certainly as the city is looking to grow our economy, one of the tools that have been used are tax incentives for businesses. This is a practice that should be evaluated on probably a biannual basis in terms of how it is we're addressing this when we look to bring business into Omaha. As a further focus of what I would really like to see, and a question that was asked to me on almost one of the first doorsteps I knocked on, is someone asked me, what would you do since ConAgra left? So I thought about it for just a moment. It certainly wasn't the first question I was expecting, but I brought up an example of a little company in Lincoln, Nebraska called Huddle. Now this company started in collaboration with the Innovation Campus that exists down in Lincoln, and it was three individuals that basically started it in their dorm room. Today, Huddle is headquartered in Lincoln. It has over 2,000 employees with offices in Omaha, Atlanta, New York City, London, and Sydney, Australia. Finding those type of businesses that exist within our market and nurturing them so that they too can grow similar to a Huddle is the way I believe we are going to grow and expand our economy. We are blessed to have a facility like the Peter Kiewit Center that helps facilitate this type of learning, and I would be looking to promote ideas such as those.
Thank you. Gilbert Ayala.
I'm not a big fan of the tax incremental financing things. I think it's just a way for politicians to think that they know how to run a business or bring a business in. I think we focused on lowering our taxes, and like I said, I believe in lowering our property taxes for the city at 10%, 5%. I believe in getting rid of a pet registration tax. I think it's utterly ridiculous that we're paying $38 for a dog and $17 for a cat and have that pet registered every year. If Thomas Jefferson and George Washington were alive today, they'd be laughing at us. As I've been walking the district, a lot of the people have been complaining about a wheel tax that was passed about 10 years ago, and it was promised that it was going to end and it was going to be permanent. We're still paying it. And again, I believe in getting rid of the restaurant tax. I think if we focus on lowering taxes on the businesses that are here, those businesses will grow, they'll hire more people, and we don't need tax incremental financing. And I just think that I'm opposed to it, and I'd rather let the free market, I'd rather let a business owner have lower taxes and have lower fees, especially on a lot of the business taxes that are out there. Like, you know, if you operate a grocery store, they're paying so much in taxes because they got so many refrigerators and all these things, and I think all of that ought to be cut so that we can hire more employees and those businesses can reinvest in their businesses. Thank you.
Thank you. Rebecca Barrientos-Patlan.
As a successful businesswoman back in the 80s and 90s, I could see we had over 100 subcontractors. We had 11 of our employees, and taxes were crazy. And honestly, we were in South Omaha, a ghost town. And what concerned me is it was our businesses had left us. They went west. And I brought people together. I called out for a prayer meeting. Let's go prayer walk up and down. Let's bring business back. Let's bring people back to our area. And it happened. People came. They came from all over. They came from the world. We are an immigrant area. But you know what? We are a flourishing South Omaha, and that's the thing. Our businesses have brought back revenues to our city in South Omaha. And I want to say there's a lot of buildings in South Omaha that our people are very talented and they have ideas, and there needs to be money to help them get into them buildings. We were all sad when Hy-Vee left and when Cinemark left. We need to bring business back to South Omaha. And South Omaha was South Omaha before Omaha was. So I'm just saying we need to get back to South Omaha and thinking about us.
Thank you. Deshaun Cunningham.
The question was, should we be using tax incentives for development? I've talked a lot about that tonight, and I want to make a difference in what it is I mean when I talk about ending TIF in its current form. Right now, it's pretty much exclusively given to luxury apartments. In all the years that I've gone to city council meetings as a resident of the city, I think I've maybe seen one or five times where TIF was used for something like an old folks home rehab or public housing development. That should be something that we look at providing tax incentives for. And when it comes to giving big businesses such as ConAgra, who received a lot of public subsidies back in the 80s to locate downtown, this is why I feel the city shouldn't be in the business of subsidizing private enterprises, because even though they're receiving public funds, they are still free as a corporate entity to make decisions independent of what the city or the residents of that city may feel. So that's one area where I find it's problematic. One thing that I would want to incentivize being grown around the district as a councilman is the idea of urban agricultural centers. I'm not talking just community gardens, but large scale structures that we can build with food production facilities indoors. Our climate's changing, we're not sure what it's gonna be like, so we need to start spending money in innovative ways and not just be so reliant on the insurance industry like Omaha is now. So if it comes down to subsidizing small businesses like TIF was intended for originally at the state legislature, then yes, subsidize those businesses.
Thank you, and now it's time for our closing statements. Each candidate has 1 minute, and we'll start with J.R. Jasso running in District 3.
When I started this campaign, I had three ideas drive me: to make neighborhoods safe, to bring economic opportunities into the district, and to be a steward with your hard-earned money. And as I knocked on door after door listening to people, things changed. I knew I wasn't reinventing the wheel. My outlook changed because of the person who said, "I can't win because of the color of my skin." The elderly citizen who said, "If I raise taxes, I'd be hunted down." The gentleman who looked me in the eye and said, "Son, are you honest?" I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "You got my vote." The woman who stopped her raking, she said to me, "Thank you. You're the only one who stopped by to take the time to talk to me. And thank you for putting yourself on the line for us." And finally, for the lady who was leaning against her husband as she prayed, she asked God to give me strength and wisdom, and thanks for doing what I'm doing. I listened, I've learned, and I'm ready to lead. Thank you. God bless you, and God bless America.
Thank you. Running in District 4, Jim Rogers.
Well, thank you again to Geri Simon and the League of Women Voters for this forum, and certainly to the candidates here tonight that have put their names forward. It's always a challenge to be able to do that, and it's certainly appreciated from my standpoint. We've covered many topics this evening, and there are many challenges in front of us. As I started out this evening, the number one issue I've been hearing is to fix our streets. This will take collaboration and focusing our priorities. I pledge to be solution-oriented as we tackle the issues of fixing our roads. We have a fabulous community, and we should have roads that complement it as well. I will continue to be a steward of our community and constantly seeking input from the people of Ward 4. To you, the viewers, I hope to earn your support, and I humbly ask for your vote. Thank you.
Thank you. District 3 candidate, Gilbert Ayala.
I also want to say thank you to the League of Women Voters for sponsoring this forum and to the candidates who are here. It takes a little bit of guts to run for public office. I just want to say I believe in lowering taxes. I believe in cutting city spending. And again, I believe in cutting the city spending. We need to get rid of that pet registration tax. We need to get rid of the restaurant tax. And we need to get our city spending under control. And if you elect me, I will go over and make myself very prominent out there and get on the mayor and get on the other city council members. The city council meetings will last longer. We're not going to be getting out early, and we're going to be going over the spending. And I will be getting the department heads in front of me, and I will go over them that they need to, why are we spending all this money on consultants, and where's our money going? And that's about it, and I want to say thank you very much for to all the people out there who will vote for me or not vote for me, but go out and vote. It's very important. Thank you.
Thank you. Running in District 4, Rebecca Barrientos-Patlan.
Thank you so much, League of Women Voters, and all this testosterone that's flying around here. I just want to say thank you to Gary Gernat for all the years that he served, not only as a Marine, but as a city councilman, and it's well appreciated. I have been taking care of South Omaha for decades, and I want you to know that I've worked with the Omaha Police Division and all the other local law enforcement to take care of our streets. I've taken care of the areas for lead. I was on that advisory. I've done quality of life for decades. I'm not going to start doing that. I have been doing that for you and mine. And I will continue to do that. And I will fight for you. I always have been. And I just want you to vote for me on April 4th and then again on May 9th. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Running in District 3, Deshaun Cunningham.
One last time, I want to thank the League of Women Voters and the other candidates that are here. I also want to take a moment and thank everyone that's supported my campaign so far. And in closing, I'm asking you all out there to vote for me on April 4th because I want to get the City Council back on the side of working people again. As a councilman, I will work to promote the safety and economic interests of all people, and I will work to make Omaha a safe and desirable place for all members of the community from the bottom to the top. If you're ready for a change, I'm asking for your vote next Tuesday. Deshaun Cunningham, District 3, thank you.
Thank you. And also running in District 3, Mark Elworth Jr.
Oh, hey, thanks again for having us. Appreciate everybody coming. Bunch of great candidates here. Just want to reaffirm, I had a couple attacks on the marijuana. I don't take it personal or nothing, but it's, you know, it's just typical. A lot of people are like that. They're kind of scared of it. But cannabis, it's safer than alcohol, cigarettes, and prescription drugs. All three things that are legally readily available to us. Alcohol is way far more dangerous. I mean, I'm talking like Donald Trump here, and it's true. It's more dangerous than... It kills people. You're wrecking cars. Marijuana doesn't do that to you. Marijuana, people relax and they communicate and they think. Cigarettes is deadly. I mean, what's it do you? It makes your teeth yellow. You stink. You're gonna die from it. You pay $6 a day for it. You pretty much to kill yourself. That's actually the biggest killer of all three. Prescription drugs. Basically, the drug dealer is your doctor nowadays.
Thank you.
It's set up.
Thank you.
Peace and love, guys.
Thank you. That concludes our forum for Omaha City Council Districts 3 and 4. The League of Women Voters of Greater Omaha would like to thank all our candidates for participating this evening. We also remind you that Election Day is upon us. Tuesday, April 4th is the primary election. The polls are open till 8 p.m., so please do get out and vote. And then the general election is on Tuesday, May 9th, not very much time between each one. If you want to binge watch all of our forums, you can do so by going to omahalwv.org. All of the forums are there. You can watch them at any time. So for the League of Women Voters of Greater Omaha, I'm Geri Simon reminding you to inform yourself about the issues and the candidates. And on Election Day, April 4th and May 9th, go vote, Omaha.